Hey guys, it's Adam from Tested, and I am in Cornwall, England, learning how to make armor with Master Armorer Terry English. But while we're here, it turns out that the apples from Terry's orchard don't fall far from the tree. Okay, keep with me on this metaphor. Terry's kids are also both makers. Terry's daughter, Lamorna, is a cosplayer and makes beautiful costumes. His son, Glenn, is not only a champion motorcycle racer, but also a master model maker. And we are now just about to visit Glenn's shop, where he makes super crazy detailed, beautiful quarter-scale motorcycles and sells them out of his house.
Okay, Glenn, so this is an example of the work that you do.
Yeah.
Tell me what this is.
Right, this is a 1971 Enville Gusta 500 three-cylinder, and it's in quarter scale.
One quarter scale.
Yeah.
And you scratch-built every last piece and part of this.
Yeah.
Every nut and bolt, every...
Well, I didn't make the nuts and bolts, but apart from the nuts and bolts, but everything is
you
handmade.
You spoke the wheels yourself.
Yeah, no, it's no computers, no 3D printers. It's completely made in the shed using old-fashioned tools. That's what I do.
Unbelievable. How many of these are you going to end up making? This is an addition, is that right?
19. Make 19, that's it. I've got other projects as well people want me to do, so... Yeah, but I'll get to that, but I've already got quite a few to make.
And this isn't the first motorcycle that you've built. This is the third, is that what you said?
Yeah.
In this scale?
In quarter scale, yes.
All right, so can we take a walk through some of the processes you use? It's not just casting, it's not just carving, it's everything. So
everything, yeah.
Walk me through some of the pieces and parts of this model and how it gets put together.
Okay, well, first of all, I always start off making the engine.
Okay.
That's the first part, because everything is centered around there. So it's like, this is the original crankcase that I made for the engine. So I started off, that's copper plates. So I came at you one evening when I wanted to do it, and I just cut the profile out of that engine and just built those up. And by the end of the evening, I had the sump made. And then obviously, next process is to put the bottom of the crankcase on.
So this is, once you have this, you cast this in silicone.
And then I have to take a silicone mold from that.
Right.
And then that's obviously cast up with like magnesium powders, and you get the magnesium effect on it as well when you buff it up. And then, so we have lots of castings here.
And when you're finished, there's cast pieces in here, cast resin, and there's white metal. Is that the process?
Yeah, we have a bit of white metal. We have a bit of white metal in there as well.
My goodness.
And then the clutches, obviously, we've got, that's copper plates, that's how they were originally. The original bark was...
And those are actual copper plates?
There's copper plated,
Wow. You're insane with the grounding wire there.
Yeah, it's got all that.
And you'll make 19 of these, but
I've got three here. These are going out as soon as they're finished.
And this is...
Carburetors.
Yeah. Look at this.
Yeah, these would just go on there like that.
You can look at it as close as you want and it still holds up.
Yeah, I get a bit carried away with it, really, detail. Things you don't even see, I just get so consumed that I just can't help it.
And the frame is also white metal? This is one of the painted,
They're originally made in copper tube, and they're all soldered together. And that's how I made the masters.
And then you have this cast in white metal. And
I cast them up now, originally. So you make them original.
Wow.
But it's still... Hell of a lot of work.
It's still a lot of work.
Sold it all together. And
they're bolted. I can see they're bolted in some places. And then you've got tapping holes to actually attach stuff in here. So it's effectively, you're rebuilding this motorcycle from scratch.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
I mean, it's almost the same. I mean, except that the engine doesn't run.
Yeah, but the hardest bits is getting the information to make, you know, the bikes are so rare. There was only a handful made back in the day. But that was obviously a works bike that the factory run. But there was a batch of about, a handful were made a few years back. And a good friend of mine, Ed, that I race, he's one of his bikes for, he bought one. And so I used that as a reference as well.
So you spend how...
But I'd already started making this when he Then he bought that bike, and then I realised I had to redo loads of
it. It must have been scary. You measured it, and there were things that were wrong, and you had to change those?
Yeah, there was a couple of bits where I didn't quite get the right. But that was good that he bought the bike, because none would have probably known, but I knew. That was the difference.
I feel you. When you measure something and it's slightly off, do you think, oh, that's probably okay, and then you think about it overnight, and you're like,
One of the main problems with this bike is, because every time Envy Augusta made one, they made about the two a year, went to Agostini, then the teammate. Every time they made one, they made it slightly different because they're all hand-built.
Right.
So there is no definitive one that's exactly correct.
So you just have to choose. Different.
Yeah, so you have to, pick a bike and just get it completely right.
Oh, my God.
Because they're all different. Slight differences, but there was differences.
I want to talk about the wheels, because I'm really amazed that the wheels have the hub. They're hubs and spokes. The spokes are actually done by hand.
I build them all up by hand. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I have a jig like this here.
Right.
Obviously, this is, and we have the hub. These are the only bits that are CNC machined. These are what my friend Ed does for me.
The outer, the rim and the hub.
He makes the rim, mm-hmm. and he makes the hub for me.
Okay.
And we just...
So the jig helps you keep the two parts in orientation while you're putting the spokes in.
So you put that on there, then you obviously put this bit on.
Yeah.
Oh. And then where's the rim? We had a rim here, what we were just doing there.
There you go.
So we put it in place like that.
And so then you sit there with the spokes.
Yeah, here we go.
Oh my goodness.
Hold that a second.
All right.
And then we have to...
Look at this. You've even etched in the actual text on the rim. That's crazy.
So we have to bend the ends over like this. And then we get... These are the little nipple bits. This is just a rough idea of what we do.
Yeah.
So we kind of have to push that through here.
And then that one goes in and locks in. And this is exactly how...
Stick it through there.
So this is precisely how a real motorcycle wheel is built.
Yeah. It's exactly how it's done, yeah. So you have to learn how to build wheels. This is another trade you've got to do.
This is hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours to put all these together.
It's a lot of hours. Most of it's spent in research, really. Like making them there. It still takes me a long while to make one.
Yeah.
It's the research and making all the original patterns that took forever. Every bit was made in copper and brass and soldered and filed. And
you also use, I saw a vacuum former in the other room?
Vacuum former, yeah, that's just, I only use that for the screens.
Oh, for the windscreen?
Just for the clear perspex screen.
All right.
That's the only bit that's vac formed on it.
Lovely. And then is this fiberglass?
Yeah, the fairing there, it's all hand laid up, fiberglass. Wow. There's one there that I took out this morning.
Oh.
That's all. But it's it's really to scale as well.
But then I'm looking at this final one, and you've actually lined it.
Yeah, that one there,
it's got
the metal ridge around the edge. That's how they were.
So you're detailing stuff that most people are never even going to see.
It's got about 200 rivets around that. Yeah.
Oh, and here's the Speedo.
Rev canter.
Sorry.
And of course, then we have the part on the belt. That's handmade. That's hand beaten.
Wait a minute! I recognize this kind of work. This is the sort of stuff your dad does.
That's the stuff. Yeah, where do you think I got it from?
Hammered aluminum.
Yeah, that's how it was. And the originals were done like this.
Wow.
And that's the one that we were doing just now, which will go on there. As you can see, it needs a little bit more work, but.
Glenn, I'm tired and thrilled just thinking about it.
Yeah. It's the same as an original one, just in quarter size, and you can't ride this one.
I love this in this shed, which reminds me of at least half a dozen of my shops over the years. You're using every single process I can possibly think of that is model making.
From
white metal, silicone casting, fiberglass layup, machining, hand assembly.
Painting.
You're doing rubber casting. So how do you do the tires? This is your tire master?
Yeah, that's the master, yeah.
Okay,
I turned that up on a lathe.
Yeah. How'd you do the treads?
The treads, yeah, they're difficult. Obviously put the lines.
Yeah, yeah.
They go in on the tread, but mm-hmm. actually the tread pattern, the zigzags.
Yeah.
I did that with a chisel.
Oh, my God.
Just sat there with a chisel. Yeah. Cheers with a scalpel, mate.
You're a better man than I am.
But you only got... Oh, my God. No, 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 you've only got to do that much. You can do that in half an hour, that bit there. You can do that. You just do that. Just do a half hour a day.
Yeah.
Just do that. And then do that bit. And then by the end of the week, half hour a day, you've got it done.
And then you cast them in rubber, and that's it.
Yeah.
Is that a silicone?
He's even got the lettering on the seats. He's done not racing.
Oh, wow. How do you do that?
That's just done with...
Applique?
Yeah, just get my friend at the sticker shop.
Yeah,
makes
yeah.
the stickers and you stick it on the master.
Oh, right, and it comes out in the mold. Amazing.
But then make a two-piece mold.
Yeah,
and make them in silicone. Sounds easy, but it took a long time. Took a lot of failures.
Yeah.
To get there.
Yeah.
In the end.
Well, when
I tried to get those done. I did try and get them done, but the best way is just get them done right, doing myself.
It just has to
be.
That's
what I found. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, also, spokes like this, they don't come off the shelf. You have to...
No, I had to get those made.
You have to have these made.
I had to have, there's a minimum order of 8,000.
So you have 8,000 spokes. You have enough for a lot of bikes.
Yeah.
I guess they can be used in multiple bikes.
Yeah. They'll do full models I do now. But there's only like 40 spokes in a wheel. So I think it should keep me going for quite a while.
And is this a... Wow.
Yeah.
This is a cast part.
Yeah.
But then I see these little bolts are real.
Yeah, little bolts, yeah. Get all those, buy those, don't make them.
These tiny little hex head.
Yeah.
And are they, oh my gosh, they're actually threaded. Look at that.
It's all screwed together. Yeah, the whole bike is screwed together. You could take it apart like a real one.
Wow.
But you've got to put it back together. That's the trouble.
Have you been asked to repair any of your old models?
I have been, yeah. And people have been a bit careless.
So they bring it into the shop.
They've been repaired, yeah, a couple of them.
Is there another bike in the future you have your eye on that you want to make?
Oh, there's lots of bikes I want to do in the future. Yeah, there's a lot. So I'm going to be doing the Brough Superior, the Levac races. I'd like to do that.
Yeah.
I just like the purity of that bike, simplicity of it as well. And that's one I'm looking forward to doing.
What was the first bike you ever built?
Manx Norton. Yeah, because that's what I was racing.
Yeah. Oh, so
I raced the Manx Norton. And... I just like the look of it. It was just a nice looking bike, and just
you kind of fell in love with it.
Yeah, I got a friend that makes through doing the sculptures I was doing. I met a chap that was making ape scale model racing cars. Mm-hmm. He was really helpful, and I was good friends of him. And I always liked what he did, and I said, "Oh, I'd like to make a motorbike." And he went, everyone thinks they can do it. It's not as easy as you think. And that was the only inspiration I needed. Yeah. But he was great. He helped me. He helped me out a great deal doing it. But it was good just need that inspiration, really.
You said you were doing bronze sculptures before that. What was that process? What were you making?
Well, I was doing, Mike Howard, a motorcycle racer.
Like a little figure.
Yeah, about 12 inches high.
Mm-hmm.
And because I used to work with my dad in the films, and we didn't have no work. So when we had no work on, I just made that.
Yeah.
Just sat there in the evenings and just made
and you sculpted it.
Mike Howard, and I mm-hmm. took it to a motorcycle show and sold 20 of them. Thought that wasn't too bad. So, then I made a pewter casting of George Formby from the film No Limit, and that sold well. And it just went on from there, really. Yeah. And then moved on to doing quarter-scale motorbikes.
The level of detail, Glenn, here is really inspiring. It's totally incredible. I mean, this looks like it's actually sewn out of leather, and this is a resin piece, yes?
Yeah, but we sewed the original. Was all.
Oh, your master was
original.
Sewn?
Yeah.
Wow.
But it was, And then we just got a really good quality silicone and resin.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look under that on the magnifying glass, you can actually see the roping of the thread in the cotton. It's that's the detail that comes up.
Well, and then you're also doing what looks like a bit of a dry brush finish on this to bring out the details or some sort of wash.
Yeah, put a bit of black on it and then rub it off of a cloth so it brings out the detail on it, yeah. You can see the grain in the leather.
It absolutely...
And the leather, I've got a real good fine grain leather because obviously it's got a bit of scale, isn't it?
Right.
I don't know what animal it came from, but we got it. We found it in the end.
I feel so at home in a shop like this. Glenn, thank you for showing me
it's been a pleasure.
Beautiful space here and your incredible models.
Been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.